Hi, I'm Dr. Johnny, and we're talking about a complication of dermal filler that everyone's worried about and that can cause devastating complications, and that is arterial injections or occlusions. And there's a lot more awareness of this now because there's just so many injections being done in this country and around the world. So I'm going to talk about different reasons it might occur. We're going to talk a little bit about products, and then I'm going to give you a few tips to help avoid it if you're an injector. So the first thing is, it's occlusion of a vessel. It's stopping blood flow to an area, and because of that, you get death of tissue. Sometimes it's partial, sometimes it's full. The territory of supply, depending on where it is, can be large, or it can be small and subclinical in that it can take care of itself. So there's variations. One point of debate that we always have, can it be intra-arterial? Well, yes, but can it be extra-arterial? So can it be compressive? There's a group of smart people who believe it cannot be. I personally think it can be. It's kind of a moot point, it's academic, but it does play a role in how we treat it sometimes. So I would say with intra-arterial injections, it's more immediate. You see the blanching, and if you think about compressive effect, there can be an immediate effect, but also externally, when you compress something and it gets swollen, and if it's hyaluronic acid, what does it do? Draws water in, that's more swelling. It can be progressive over hours and hours, and the sign typically is pain. That's one of the harbingers that this is happening. Before we get into the tips, I want to talk about two misconceptions. And one is, someone will say, well, I know my anatomy, and it's ultimately very important. Many of us do cadaver dissection workshops, one or two or three a year, and I think it's important, always refreshing anatomy. The problem is, this happens to the best injectors in the world who know everything about anatomy and do this on a daily basis because, A, you're in the area that these vessels are, but more importantly, B, there's variations in anatomy. We're all built different, so you can know perfectly where you believe something is, and on a given individual, it isn't there. And this can happen 20, 30, 40% of the time. Vessels and nerves can be in a different area. The second one is people use vein finders or devices where they look for veins. It's great for bruising because you can avoid the veins where you're injecting. It doesn't pick out the arterial supply, and that's because the arteries are deeper, there's connective tissue around them. You might see it, but there's a good chance with that you're not going to see arterial supply. So now we're going to go into five tips. Number one is injector's cadence. So a steady injection and not too fast. And the reason this is important, sometimes you get retrograde flow, and if you are around a vessel, chances are there's a nerve there, and patients will be, they'll show some degree of pain. And if they do, you know, the veins, the arteries, and the nerves go together. So you might pull back from there. If you're injecting fast, you could miss that. So slow injections help prevent, and if it is occurring, you see it before you put too much product. The second is, if you're bolusing product, think about what product. Some products are reversible, some aren't, and some like Sculpt are coming to water. So it's small, it's 50 micron size, and also you won't get the external compression that you could with an HA because it's water, it won't compress. So not bolusing, and if you do bolus, pull back on the plunger. The third one is a vial of filler, and you look what naturally comes with it to the injector, needles. So needles pierce. Whereas a micro cannula has a blunt tip on the end and the port is more proximal to the end, it's not right at the end. And because it's blunt, it goes around the vessels and nerves. Sure, it's more comfortable, you can reach more areas, but there's perceived to be a safety benefit amongst all the other benefits going around the nerves as opposed to piercing them. The next one is injecting perpendicular to the vessel as opposed to with it. And that's where knowing your anatomy does help a lot. If you know a vessel runs this way and you inject with it, if you go in it, you're much likely to cannulate a longer area. If you go across it, you might bruise someone, but it's less likely that you're going to inject in the lumen of the vessel. So injecting perpendicular, that's why you see, one of the reasons you see people inject the nasolabial fold, one of the most dangerous areas to inject, yet it's where we all learn. That's why you see them inject sometimes in what we call old school ferning method, because the vessel goes this way in that fold, and of course it connects to the upper face, which is quite dangerous. The nose, the forehead, and the nasal fold are the three most dangerous areas for this. The fifth way to help prevent this is by using a threading technique when possible. And I talked about bolusing and what's involved with that. When you do bolus and you pull back, of course, hold it for 6-7 seconds. It's not foolproof, but it's part of it. The last one here, threading. The idea is if you're moving constantly and you're watching the skin, you're unlikely to bolus in one area or put too much in one area. So the threading technique in and of itself is likely safer. Here's the curious thing I always, when I'm training, I see people do, and I just don't know why. If you imagine you're threading with this technique, they go in and they stop, and then they pull back, and then they inject a thread. When you pull back on the plunger, you're only seeing where you are in that point in time. There's really not much use of threading and pulling back on the syringe in one point, because every time you pull the needle back, you're in a different spot. Yet I see people do it. And I think mentally, they're not understanding the concept of why we're threading in the first place. And that is, the constant movement would mean if you're in a vessel, you're not putting a lot of product there. And it's more, the more product you put in one area, if it's the wrong area, is what creates the problem. So there's five things you can do. You probably have many other techniques that you guys have certainly commented before. It's the five that came to my mind. I think I'd be remiss not mentioning that there are ways to help prevent it, but if it does occur, there's also things you can do, like dissolving the product if it's dissolvable, like hyaluronic acid, massaging, warm compresses, aspirin, and blood thinning. You can use hyperbaric oxygen is another good way. I will mention that things like if you put nitrates to give yourself more blood flow to the area, or if you use things like Cialis or Viagra, some people take those, so that there's more blood flow to the area, you can get that steel phenomena. And also, if you're dissolving, think about potential distal spread. So every one of those has its own issues, and every clinic will have its own policy on what they do and how to deal with it. Have it written up before it happens, because when this happens, you want a kit with everything there. So that's arterial occlusions, whether it's intravascular or extravascular. Let us know what you think about that as well below, and hopefully that helps give people an idea what it is, how to prevent it, and a little bit about what to do, although that's not a complete overview of how to treat it. Definitely have that written up in your own clinic. Thanks for joining me here. I look forward to your comments. Also, join me over on Instagram and subscribe to this channel for continued helpful tips. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.